good to see each and every one of you. Well, it is Mother's Day, and it's a wonderful day today. So if you are here today, we'd like for you just to kind of stand for a moment and just greet the people next to you and just tell them what a wonderful day it is. Well, we have a couple of announcements. We've got a photo booth downstairs. So if you'd like to take a picture with your family or your loved ones or just by yourself, I kind of did a couple of those this morning. We're going to frame them later on. They're downstairs, and so in the fellowship hall, and they're going to be after the service. We'd love for you to have that opportunity to take that picture. A couple other things. This Wednesday is business meeting. And so we want to encourage every one of y'all to come and participate in the life of the church. And then lastly, on May 22nd, mark your calendars. It's not in the bulletin, but May 22nd, Wednesday, May 22nd, we're going to have a prayer service here in this service, or in this room. And so we're going to just spend some time giving this church over to God and asking for his blessings to continue upon this place and asking for his guidance and his direction and praying over the seats and the pews and the podium. And so we don't want to move without him. And so this is the time where we're going to just spend some time together as a church praying in this sanctuary. It's always a wonderful time. So May 22nd, Wednesday, 6 p.m. Couple other things. If you are a guest with us here today, we'd love for you to fill out a little guest connection card. It's a green card in the pew back in front of you. Nobody's going to follow up and come to your house this week, but next week might be different. So, but no, we just love to connect with you and just start a conversation with you. And so let's go ahead and prepare our hearts as we worship the risen Christ. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for David and Missy as they come and lead us in song. We ask that you would meet us here and you would profoundly shape our life. God, we thank you so much for this day and for this church, and we ask that you would speak to the small part of our hearts. In your name we pray, amen.
As a call to worship, we're going to sing Remember Me. This is a song, typically we sing this at weddings when the parents and grandparents are being set. But it's a special Mother's Day for me. As you all know, I lost my mother. And the words to this song, listen very closely, about how we raise our children to be Christ-like, about how we raise our children to go and teach and to preach. But then they leave. We talked about in our Sunday school this morning about how the missionaries go. And we sometimes have to let our children go be Christ-like elsewhere. Bible cracked and faded by the years. Remember me in a sanctuary filled with silent prayer. And age to age and heart
bound by grace and peace. Child of wonder, child of God, I remembered you. Remember me when the color of the sunset fills the sky. Remember me when you pray in tears of joy fall from your eyes. And child of wonder, child of God, I remembered you. Remember me. Remember me when the children leave their Sunday school with smiles. Remember me when they're old enough to teach, old enough to preach, old enough to lead.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, today we remember the mothers who have gone before us for their love, sacrifice, struggle, and joy. We thank you. Lord, we remember the mothers of Scripture who are part of our story as we are a part of your story for their courage, faith, love, and fierceness. We thank you. Lord, we remember those who have not given birth to us but mothers to us for their love, for their gift of themselves that they have given, we thank you. For the women who struggle with fertility, for those women who have felt the loss of a child, for their tears, for their strength, for their wisdom, for their lives, we thank you. It is in your name we pray. Amen.
Well, I'll tell y'all what. Why don't y'all stay over there, and then we'll have y'all come up one at a time over here, all right? So why don't we start with... Oh, go ahead with the first one. You go ahead.
No, I'm sorry.
No. Y'all come on up here because the people on the balcony can't see you. We got to let everybody see. Okay. So this is, again, this is Asha, and this is Dee, and this is baby Xavier. Now, Xavier usually wears a bow tie. And he's a good friend of mine. He's actually my neighbor. Yes, Xavier, but the whole family is my neighbor. And so I'll tell you, I have seen God work in their lives, and it is so amazing. So tell us how old baby X-Man is.
5 months.
He's five months?
5 months.
Okay, okay. And D is a big LeBron fan.
Oh, yeah.
Just kidding. He loves Michael Jordan's. But anyways, this baby is absolutely precious. Oh, my goodness. All right, let's bring up the next one here. Y'all stay right here. We'll go over on this side. And everybody wants to see. Now, the tradition is I take your baby and then I go walk around. I'm not going to do that, okay? All right, next up, who do we have?
All right, we have the Underwood family with us. This is Daddy David, little boy Drake, and Savannah, our sweet girl, and Mom and Stephanie.
Oh. And David got a haircut for this. We're thankful for him. I want to tell you, I'm so thankful for this family. As I've seen, this is I have seen God work tremendously in both of these families, and in particular, I've seen God work tremendously in David over the last couple of months. And so, who's that? Is that Savannah? Hi, Oh, she's got. I scared her. Okay. I can't. I scare little kids. Okay. You remember that Tommy boy? Okay. All right, I'm going to wrap this up before it goes downhill. Okay. You guys have just a sweet and precious family. I wanted to just remind you guys of what this is. This is not a baby baptism, right? This is more of a parent commissioning. What you are saying in this moment is that you standing up here in front of everybody is what you're saying is, listen, I'm going to do everything I can to point my children to Christ. And the whole point of the sermon today, I hate to spoil it, but it's that you can chase for a lot of different things in this world, but what you are going to do as families is you're going to tell your kids to chase for the one thing that matters most, and that's God. And so this is also a time, you know, the church loves this time because they love to see the babies and they love to see the new life here and they love to see, you know, how phenomenal he looks. But really, this is a time for the church also to come alongside of you and partner to say that this is going to be a safe space where you can come and bring your family. But this is also a space where we as a church, deacons, leaders, nursery leaders, Sunday school teachers. This is a place where we point people to Christ as well. And so this is what this is about. And so so I'm going to say something and y'all say we do after it if you agree with it, okay? So in presenting to the parents, in presenting your children to the Lord, do you promise independence of God's grace and the partnership of this church to teach them the truth of the Christian faith, to set a Christian example before them, to bring them up in the ways of the Lord Jesus, and to encourage them to accept Jesus Christ as Savior under the guidance of the Holy Spirit? Okay. I love it. No, I love it. I love this. I do. And you know what's great is we got like three more in the queue too, so it's... Lens, you want one more? No? Okay. She said no. Okay. All right. Minister to the congregation. This is y'all's part. And you say, we do after the following. Do you as members of this church promise to partner with these parents in the teaching and the training of Xavier, Savannah, and Drake that they may be led in due time to know Christ as Savior, confess Him in baptism, and follow him in discipleship. If you accept this responsibility, please indicate it by standing. I want you to take a moment just to look at this. Parents, just look at this for a second. And I want you to notice that all the people here, they're for you. That, just drink that in for a second. All these people are for you, even when your daughter's going down the stairs. I mean, honestly, they are for you, and they want the best for you, and they want you, your whole family, to have an intimate relationship with Christ. So let us all pray, and I will close it off with a prayer. Father, we thank you for these families. God, we thank you for Savannah. We thank you for Drake. We thank you for Xavier. We thank you for the parents. God, we ask that this would be a time in their lives that they would all point to you and that they would all chase you and that they would forsake everything else and go after you. Let their parents here be godly examples to these children. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Yeah, go ahead.
Whenever John and I have to be the interim worship leader, I'm a little selfish. The songs that I picked for us to sing and the choir's going to sing are songs that I kind of grew up. My grandmother was 13 when she married. She had 9 children before she was 25 in Madison County. I don't know how she did that, but that's what they tell me. Anyway, these are songs that I could hear her singing as she was washing dishes or changing grandbaby diapers. So that's why when you hear these songs, what's this song got to do about Mother's Day? It's kind of selfish. I'll stand now and sing together hymn number 15, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Come Thou Fount.
512 will be our offertory hymn. This is a song that some of the choir didn't know. How many people knew that know this song? Oh, Perfect Love. Nobody. Nobody. Okay. If you want to sit down, you can. Is that what you want me to do? This will be our offertory prayer, or our offertory hymn.
Father, we thank you for another beautiful day that we could gather and worship as a church family. Dear Lord, we thank you for the many blessings you bestow upon us daily. At this time in our service, we return just a portion of what you so richly blessed us with. Ask your blessings on these tithes and offerings, and may they be used for the furtherment of your kingdom. All these things I pray in your precious holy name. Amen.
Thank you.
Okay, well, we're going to be in Proverbs 31 if you want to join us there in your Bible. Proverbs 31. Today I come to you and I recognize that it is a complicated day for some. It's complicated for a lot of different reasons. And I don't want to necessarily get into all the different complications, but I do recognize that this day brings a lot of emotions for a lot of different people. And so what I want to do today is just kind of step back and say, okay, let's not focus exactly on mothers or motherhood, but let's give this opportunity to focus on what makes a godly woman, what makes an excellent woman. The question this morning is, what makes an excellent woman? The writer in Proverbs asked that very question, what makes an excellent woman? And so to help us accomplish that, we're going to be going to the book of Proverbs, Proverbs chapter 31. It's best known because it gives the portrait of biblical womanhood. Now, I will say this. I recognize that this topic of womanhood has been abused and misabused and just kind of distorted throughout the ages. I typically see that people either go on one extreme or the other. It's like this one extreme is like, you know, men and women are essentially the same. And it's like, we are all equal, absolutely. But God has made man and woman, and there are differences between the two. And then there are some that would go on the other side, and they would say, you know, a woman's place is in the kitchen and cooking and cleaning and barefoot and pregnant. You know, it's like this whole other side over here that really is an abuse. It's male chauvinism. And so I recognize that there's these like very competing ideas on what it means to be a woman, and I also recognize that I am not a woman, and so I'm going to be talking about womanhood today. So today I'm going to do my best to be faithful to the text, and we're going to let the text talk and not so much me. And so we ask ourselves, what is an excellent woman? Proverbs 31:10 says, an excellent woman who can find, for her worth is far above any jewels. So this woman that he begins to outline, she says she is excellent. Now the term excellent is a very unique term in the Old Testament because it's a military term. It's a term meant to describe a warrior, a chief, somebody who was like leading a lot of people. You might think of a colonel or a general. And he says, this is the picture of biblical womanhood, somebody who's capable of leading an army. And if you were on the other army side, you would be saying, whoa, that other person over there looks excellent. There's a cut above the rest. The air about them is different. When they walk into a room or an environment, woo, there is something that the atmosphere changes. The word excellent conveys that there is something different with this person. They are cut above the rest. There's something not ordinary, but something extraordinary. And that is the word that the writer of the Proverbs uses to describe what this biblical woman is. It's an excellent woman. There's something different about her. And oh, by the way, there's not one part of Proverbs 31 that talks about the outward appearance of a woman. Not one portion, nothing talks about the outward characteristics of this woman. It doesn't talk about her complexion, her eyes, her nose, her body, any kind of body parts, right? It doesn't talk her weight, nothing. He's smart for not saying that. Okay, so this is what happens when I go off script. Okay, so because in Proverbs, we're seeing a different kind of woman. Of course, we can't go verse by verse through this. Ollie, that would be absurd. We gotta be first in line at the blue aisle. We gotta beat the Methodist, okay? So we can't go verse by verse, but I do want to pull out 3 points as to what makes this excellent woman that God talks about. So we're gonna be talking about 3 things that we pull out from Proverbs. The first one, he says that strength and dignity are her clothing. Strength and dignity are her clothing. As the writer begins his summary on this excellent woman, he does in fact talk about her outward appearance. But we know that he is talking about the outward appearance because he's talking about her clothes. However, what's interesting, he flips the script. He brilliantly flips the script on us, because when we think of outward appearance, we usually think of physical characteristics. But what he says is, when you look at this godly woman, when you look at a godly woman, the first thing that you should notice is not her physical beauty, but her strength and dignity. In essence, you should see her character. Strength in this context means having a powerful heart and a powerful soul and a powerful mind, and somebody who's not afraid to use it or speak it. Dignity means poised and stateliness. So I guess if you just want to kind of put a bow on it and kind of sum it all up, here's what I would say. The first thing the writer wants you and I to know is that about women, about godly women, is that true beauty always comes from the inside. True beauty always comes from the inside. It comes from within. We should be way more concerned about a woman's heart than her outward appearance. And unfortunately, I fear for my children, because we have royally flipped that script in America, have we not? We have taught our young people to say, first go after the outward characteristic and then hope that they have character. Right? That's what we say. And there's dating apps now. Does anybody remember Hot or Not? Any of my generation? No, I guess that's the only one. Seventh grade. Okay. Lucy, do you remember it? Lucy remembers it. Okay. So there are literally dating apps now where you just look at people's picture and then you just flip left or right. I don't have the dating app, by the way. Sorry. Just let's clarify that. Lindsay, this is just a home screen, okay? She knows my passwords, okay? There's literally just, you look online and there's pictures and you either swipe left or right if you think this person is attractive. I mean, that's what this world has come into. That's the state of affairs, and I fear for my kids. Because it's like, that's just the culture that they're going to grow up in. We have totally flipped the script, and the Bible is entirely clear that true beauty always comes from the inside first. Beauty shouldn't be about changing yourself to fit some ideal model or fit some ideal what's socially acceptable. Real beauty, the interesting, the truly pleasing kind of beauty, listen, always comes from within. Always comes from within. And so for all my single people in the room, you don't need to raise your hand or anything. But if you're out there and you're looking for a spouse or whatever, listen, first worry about character. That is the primary thing that the Bible talks about when it's talking about this godly woman. Secondly, so we talked about it, strength comes from within, it's character. Secondly, the writer says when she opens her mouth and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. I want you to notice that this chapter was written to a man. Proverbs 31 was written to a man. It was not written to women. I know Lisa Turkhurst and all the Lifeway ladies, every women's ministry is Proverbs 31's ministry. I get it. But Proverbs 31 was written to men to teach something to men about women. And one of the things that I think this verse is saying is that God oftentimes speaks men through the profoundly through the women in our lives. He oftentimes speaks profoundly through the women in our lives. I want you to take an inventory and I want you to think, okay, what women are close in my life? Like, what women have an influence in my life? I will need you to understand what God is saying is God often speaks through those women. In other words, you can't cast them aside. You can't put them outside of the table. They need a seat at the table. So I've been married 12 years now, and in those 12 years, there have been three times, that I have pulled the husband card, the proverbial husband. Everybody know what the husband card is? No, it's like where you're looking at a situation and everybody's looking at it and you're saying, okay, this is, you know, looks like there's some options here. And maybe, you know, it's like, okay, your wife wants to go this way, but you want to go this way, you just pull out the husband card. I've pulled that card out 3 times in my life, okay? 3 different times I've said, listen, I hear you, honey. I appreciate it. I'm listening to you. We're a team, but God has just told me we need to go over here. 3 times I have done that. 2 times I've been very sorry I did it, okay? I've been very, very sorry I did it. The one time, though, I was right on the money. And I don't forget that. Lindsay might, but I don't forget it. No, just kidding. Listen, ladies, let's just face it. God has given you a level of discernment that men don't always have. That's why we play like weird sports, like, you know, like we'll climb on top of a ladder and see who can like, you know, play baseball on top of a ladder. I don't know. It's like you just have a discernment that we don't always have. You've got this sixth sense about you. Now, the key is don't be getting all arrogant. You don't hit 1,000 every time. You are known to do some things wrong. But there is something to this idea that God speaks to us through the women in our lives. And men, we have the option, or we have the choice to decide whether or not we're going to be the wise person who listens to the women in our lives, or we're going to be the fool who does not. So let's recap. A woman's beauty always comes from within. There's wisdom from the mouth of this godly lady. And lastly, she looks well to the ways of the future and does not eat the bread of idleness. That term, looks well, means she literally leans forward and puts her eyes on many things at one time. She can look at a lot of different things. She's a multitasker, and she can think about a lot of things at once. Somebody better say amen on that one, right? There's this book that's called Four Men, and it helps us understand the mind of a woman. And in it, the author says this: here's the main thing you need to know. The key reason for all these female windows is the ratio of gray matter to white matter in the corpus callosum superhighway between the hemispheres of the women's brain. Have I lost anybody yet? Okay. Essentially, gray matter is like computing power of a brain, where actual process and functioning is done, while white matter is like the network cables that connect the computers for speed, and they allow them to work together and send signals from one computer to the next. Now, here it is. Women have more white matter in their brains' superhighway than men's do. In practical terms, what does this mean? What did I just say? Here's what it says. Women's brains are designed specifically to process a lot of different things quickly. At the same time, while men's brains are designed specifically to process deeply only one thing at a time without being distracted. Can I get an amen for some scientific data? Amen. Amen. So fellas, what does this mean? It means that women are like computers, and they can have 7 or 8 applications going up, 20 different internet browsers at the same time, and there's no pop-up blockers. I mean, they can process it all. You and I were like Ataris. And you remember that game, the ping game? What's that ping game called? Huh? Pong. We're like Pong. I mean, it's just one ball in the screen. It's going back and forth. I mean, we're thinking about that ball. We know where it is. It's just one ball, though. And all the time, my wife says, and we have this ability to think about nothing, too, don't we? Don't we? I mean, one of the few, I mean, when my wife and I fight, I mean, that's just part of natural family life, right? One of the times we got in a fight was, she just said, what are you thinking about? I said, nothing. Like, nothing. I'm not thinking about a single thing. Like, what do you mean you're not thinking about nothing? Like really, I'm not thinking about a single thing. Well, you got to be thinking about something. Sweetie, I promise. There ain't nothing. I mean, it's just a screensaver. Nothing. I mean, nothing. Men, we can shut it down. But here's what I want you to know. God has created women with a phenomenal and incredible capacity. And you don't see the same language used for men in the Bible. That does not mean that men are inferior. That does not mean that. It just means that we're wired differently. And so, and I think we have to understand that what Proverbs is offering us is this picture of a godly woman. So that leaves us to our original question. What makes an excellent woman? Well, this verse is, verse 30 says this, charm is deceitful, beauty is in vain, but a woman who fears the Lord shall be praised. This verse is not saying if you are beautiful, you're wrong. That's not what it's saying. Here's what it's saying. The same thing that makes a godly woman is the same thing that makes a godly man. And that is somebody who chases after the right thing. What this proverb was saying to us, listen, ladies, don't spend your life chasing beauty. Don't let that be the sum total of who you are. Men, you could write that same proverb and say, don't let your job be the sum total of who you are. Chase the right thing. And so my word to you this morning, before we get to the blue aisle, my word to you this morning is I'm going to ask you, what are you chasing? What is it with you, whether you're retired, whether you're just starting your career, whether you're up late nights with your kids because they're regressing in their sleep, whether you're in the middle of midlife crisis, my question to you is the same. What are you chasing with your life? What is it, if you take a little inventory right now and you ask yourself, what is the thing I am chasing? Because there's a little trail in everybody's life. You look at all your time, you look at all your money, you look at all your resources, you look at all your energy, you look at all of this, and at the end of that little trail, there's going to be a throne, and at the top of the throne is the thing that you are chasing. What is it that you are chasing? And if you are chasing the wrong thing, here's the wonderful thing about our God, is that he can always say, hey, it's time to go on a different path. Put me at the top of that pedestal. Would you please pray with me? Father, we thank you that you are the God who gives us this picture of a godly woman. We thank you for the women in our lives here. We thank you that you have orchestrated them in such a way that they are blessings to us. Father, we thank you for that. God, we also ask right now for any one of us in here that would be cataloging and thinking to ourselves, what are we chasing? And if we're not chasing you, God, we ask for forgiveness and we ask for the strength that we would go back on track to chase after you and the things of you. We don't want to waste our life chasing something lesser. In your name we pray. Amen. If you would, please stand. This is the time where we have some spiritual movement in our church. And so if you're here this morning and you have never chased God, you don't know what chasing God means. You're chasing all the wrong things and you feel this emptiness. If that is you, I ask that you come on down because we would absolutely love to pray for you. I would love to pray for you and show you what your life is worth, or show you what your life could be like when you chase the right thing. If you're here this morning and you want to join a church and you want to be members here, if that's you, you say, listen, I want to be a part of a church that's chasing Jesus constantly. If that is you, come down. We would love to accept you. And lastly, if it's your birthday here and you say, I want to come down to celebrate and say, with my life, this year I am chasing after him. If that is you, come on down because we would love to celebrate and honor you.
right. Well, we have some birthdays here. First, we got Keisha here. It is her birthday.
Last Wednesday.
And very good. And it is their three-year, this is the Ray's three-year anniversary. On Tuesday. But I will say, he said, ladies, I want you to all know, this is what he said to me. He said, if women have so much white, or so much white matter and whatever in their brain, why can't they choose where to eat? He said it. He said it, not me. And then we also have here Ada Adams. Ada, do you want to stand or do you want to sit? You'll stand right here. Ada Adams here. She is just a delight to the kingdom, and she's going to be turning 91. Isn't that incredible? That's so incredible. Well, please come down and give everyone the right hand of fellowship as we leave here. And then next week, we start back in Mark for a season. And so I'm excited to jump back into the Gospel of Mark. And then also, do not forget, business meeting this Wednesday. Let us pray before we go. Father, we thank you that you are our sovereign God and that you have absolutely everything under control. And so we rest in that. In your name we pray. Amen. Go in peace, everyone. Happy birthday.